Reading as he's writing me back to the text. Why did Jesus keep going to Mary's house? Or Martha's house, actually. It was Martha's house. And Mary, you know, I think Mary is an American. Because she is in Martha's house. And when Jesus came, she wasn't about serving. She pulled out a chair. Crossed her legs, and Martha is in the kitchen cooking. She said, well, let her take care of it. I'm hanging with the Lord. Why did Jesus keep going there? Because they sustained him in ministry. Then I was always there. And they didn't just feed Jesus, they fed 12 men. It's only when you have a desire to know what God is doing and how you fit in it that revelations come to you. And then he gives you your own answer. And then when you act on it, hey, how did Mary know that this one act would put her in the scriptures? And Jesus said, wherever this gospel is preached, whatever this woman has done, must be preached. Hallelujah. Yeah. Glory to God. Yeah. Hey. Huh? Let me get happy for a moment. You see, because after you've struggled like me, I will talk about some of these things, you know, in this message this morning. You see, after you've struggled, you when you haven't struggled, you don't know the pain. Hallelujah. You don't know the pain of delays and things not happening, and it looks like things are not working, and Satan is mocking you and lying and making noise. Because if you looked at Mary, what was Satan telling her all her life? You got 7 devils. You've laid down for every man you've ever met. And yet God comes. That's why I preach to anybody. I don't care where you've been. I don't care what you've done. I don't care how many people you've slept with. But Jesus can make a new woman out of you if you will find a connection to the throne. I believe that the biggest mistake men make is you meet a woman. Now you want to know everybody she's been with and everything she's ever done. And then after they tell you all of that, then Satan will start tormenting you. You need to receive who you got and let everything that's past be in the, under the blood. Because you can't handle what you say you want to know. And here the devil will come and start tormenting you, and then you lay down, you start watching, you know, how they did it. You know, how they kiss. You know, I wonder what they did. And here you go. And now you're mad and angry. Well, how many people have you slept with? Since you all are talking about sleeping. I slept last night, but I was alone. You know, because this is the warfare raging in a man's life. He wants to be intimate with women. But he don't want the woman in his life to be intimate with anybody. Then where are you going to find those? I want to celebrate the Lord Jesus because Mary has 7 devils. The Bible says Jesus was tempted in all points. Do you know how many demons messing with him from Mary? Trying to make him lust. And he overcame it. And drove them devils out. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Because that's the battle. That's warfare. I told a story once. This lady came to see me. She was very beautiful, light-skinned, well-endowed, her thighs showing and shining like the sun. And she didn't have hardly any clothes on. I said, well, if I shake this thing a little bit, it will pop out. Everything just hanging. I said, did you come for counseling or did you come to seduce me? She said, well, why? You don't have to look at it. I said, where will I be looking? I'm a man. You can't come into my office and breasts hanging out and thighs hanging out. God programmed me to respond to it. I'm not down low. What nonsense. I said, you need to leave, go put some clothes on. What do you mean you don't have to be looking at it? Where will I be looking? So you're in my office, but I have to be looking up. Okay, Lord, I give you praise. Bless the soul. You're crazy. I said, you go put some clothes on. Leave my office. When Fred Price was alive, I heard him on television. He said, now, this drop-dead gorgeous woman came to his office, and it was one day he was really struggling, and he fighting these devils, and she came, and she got a husband problem. Okay. He said, hold up, I'll be right back. He went and found some mothers in the church. He said, okay, now you'll come minister to this woman, because if I minister to her, it will not be... We will not be canceling. This will be laying on of hands. So he brought some mothers of the church and tipped on out, got in his car, and went home. Hallelujah. Amen. This is warfare.
Yes. Yeah. Amen.
The Bible says that Jesus loved Mary and Martha. And he went there all the time. As the skit showed you, they would make, they cooked for him, and he was sharing the mysteries of the Word of God with them. And then suddenly, even though I'm talking about these things and you're laughing, but I'm trying to show you life. Jesus loved them. But Satan attacked. And many times you and I will start making noise. Why will this happen? I've been faithful. I'm tithing. I'm doing the right thing. Why will we come under this kind of attack? I want to refer to that message I preached last year. What do you do when the mountain is you? And all of a sudden, this is not your expectation. The Lord Jesus has been coming to your house. You don't expect Satan to come in there and attack your brother. These are the things that throw believers. You have expectation of blessing and breakthrough. But instead an attack occurs. And the enemy begins to war against your heart. Wait a minute. We've been feeding him. We've been taking care of his team. How can my brother get sick? I didn't read further into the text. But I'm going to be telling you the scriptures but with revelation. Because God was showing me when I was praying this morning. I don't care what attack comes. He said to me, it doesn't matter how Satan attacks you or challenges you or opposes you. He said, don't say anything. Wait for my verdict. Yeah. No, he said, you didn't understand what I'm saying. He said that Mary and Martha sent a message to Jesus. Come, he whom you love is sick. and he didn't show up. But the Bible said, oh, I pray you get it. The Bible said that when they told Jesus that Lazarus was sick, he said, this sickness is not unto death. Hey, I pray I show you the mysteries of faith. If I give this message, I didn't want to change the title, but if I give it another title, I will call it Faith Beyond the Grave.
Amen.
When my deadline has run out,
amen.
Will every... Hey.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. Are you hearing me? He said, tell the people to stop running their mouth. When the enemy attacks, don't say anything. I need to hear from Jesus. Death is staring us in the face. But he said, this sickness is not unto death. He said, but it's for the glory of God. How many things do you need to give that prophetic word to this afternoon? This thing will not take me out. God is going to get the glory out of this. Is somebody hearing what I'm telling you? I'm trying to show you. If it's the people from on the other side, they say, well, it's, you know, what they call it? It's, you know, from behind the veil.
Oh, yeah, behind the veil. Yeah.
Watch. You see, because this is the struggle you're having. You hear, this is my your supernatural breakthroughs. This is limitless grace. My miracle shall flow like a river. And then you look up, things are going the other way. Don't you see what Nate did? He weaponized the decree. He took it out and started reading it to these contracts that are failing. He said, you don't have a right to say anything when you haven't heard from Jesus. Jesus said this, you see this? It will not lead to death. Whoa, somebody fooled me. Didn't he die? You see? But if you're part of this current generation, you start running your mouth. Mm-hmm. I thought he said he wasn't going to die. He said, this stuff will bring me glory. That is the concept of glory that I'm trying to reveal to you. He said that the time came for Jesus to be glorified.
Amen.
What's he talking about? He was talking about his death. He said, but it's time for him to be glorified. He said, now, this sickness is not unto death, but it's for the glory of God. But for God to get the glory, it got to be so bad that no man can handle it. See, you cannot want glory, but you don't have courage to still believe, even all the data is wrong and staring against you. I pray that you will catch what I'm preaching. Huh? Are you hearing what I'm showing you? He said, this sickness is not unto death. That's the testimony I was giving you about Eagle One. Satan was pressuring me to breach myself. Go to that meeting. Go negotiate with Epps to lease airplanes. So I'm not doing anything until I hear from God. You can pressure me into a panic. You can pressure me into unbelief so you can get control of me. You don't know that Satan is trying to hand you unbelief so he can control you. But when you refuse, hey, glory to God, you deliver yourself from every chain, isn't it? That Paul and Silas praised God at midnight in jail that caused the yokes to break. And the prison doors opened. We are so eager to accept unbelief. As if to clarify matters. You see, now Jesus loved Mary and Martha. But in the American mindset, well, if he loved me, then he should have responded immediately. If you don't respond immediately, then it means you don't love me. That's the way Americans think. They don't know the fruit of patience. I ask you again, what do you do when the mountain is you? But this mountain has been created. How has it been created? Delays. Delays. I had some resurrection agents yesterday, and I was telling them my story. And they felt like crying. They said, well, why haven't you told these ones? I said, well, it just hadn't come up. You see, because when you are looking at what God has done, you don't remember where he brought me from. Because when I came to America, my family paid one semester fees. That's all the money my brother in Rochester could muster. It's not like today, everything is instant. Mm-hmm. In those days, international transactions moved by what they call mail transfer. You keep putting the money into a pile, it gets to a size, then they move it. Then everybody will get their money wherever it's going. God made sure that that money disappeared for 6 years. I couldn't receive it. I didn't know he was training me to be the man talking to you now.
Amen.
But God doesn't explain. That's why you give yourself a slap offering if you're in depression. How can a finite man judge an omniscient God? He said that Jesus heard this and made a pronouncement. And God said for me to ask you, what have I said about what you're going through? As if he knew what I was thinking. Of course he knew. But I was saying, well, where do I begin to think? He said, your thought processes on what I already said in my word. Before you start looking for another direct another direct revelation or word. At least start with, by the stripes of Jesus, I'm healed. Start with, my God shall supply. You start with the promises of God. You start there before we start looking for anything else, because we know that he has said this and he will not lie. Because he sent back a word, said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of Man will be glorified thereby. He said, God will give me glory out of this, Jesus said. And for God to give him glory out of it, Lazarus had to die and get buried 4 days. I wish I had my preach on, but I'm doing my best for this few minutes. Watch. I'm going back and forth, but watch this line and see what it will do for you and see if you can handle it. You mean you believed God and died, and you are buried, and yet your destiny is not over. Because Jesus never agreed.
Yes, Lord.
How do you die? And then you are buried. And 4 days later, here he comes. I told you, he told me, I can come whenever I get ready. Because I have power to change it. And when I come, I make up for lost time. You cannot hear it without believing it. That's why I asked them to do that drama. Because Lazarus crossed over into eternity. And all of a sudden he said, wait a minute. I hear him calling me. Watch. Jesus was talking with the Jews that had given him grief. He said, you see, he said, God is not the God of the dead, but of the living. You remember that? He says, the God of Abraham. He said, these guys are alive. Otherwise, God will not be identifying with them. And I was reading this story this morning. Jesus said to his disciples, okay, we're going back into Judea. And the Lord said to me, do you see how many disagreements that were in my group? They said, why are you trying to go into Judea when they're trying to stone you? Then Thomas, as I preach, Thomas said, let's go and die with him then. Said, this is a suicide mission. All of that was raging. He said that Jesus came out and told them plainly, Lazarus is dead. And I am glad that I wasn't there. To the intent, you might believe. I keep telling believers, the reason your faith is not strong is that you've experienced powerful miracles and you forgot them. They didn't change you. That's the difference between you and I. I mark my own. I celebrate it. I talk about it. I build on it. I use it to believe for greater things. 2 years ago, I was shaking in my boots over Igoan. And now I'm believing for two. What am I trying to show you? Maybe I should read it to you. Jesus says, all right, come. Let's go to him. See, you don't go to a dead man. If Jesus had accepted that Lazarus had died, he would have said, okay, let's go to Mary and Martha. He said, no, let's go meet Lazarus. But yet I'm dead. The enemy is making noise. People have given up on me. But my Lord said, no. You are still on my program. I'm still coming for you. As soon as I get to your grave, you're coming out of it. Hallelujah. How many of you are going to come out of what you're in? Even as I'm preaching to you this afternoon, you're going to come out of this mess in the name of Jesus.
Beloved, this is the fire of the Holy Ghost by his word. Coming to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Did you catch resurrection grace from this ministry? Yes, my own deadline may pass. Yes, things may be dead to me. But if my Lord has not said that they are dead, they are not dead. I said it in the message, you don't go to a dead man, you go to the relatives that are alive. He said, let's go to his sisters so we can console them. He said, no, let's go to Lazarus. That means my destiny is not over. I told you that when God gave me my first breakthrough, I thought I was doing bad. I was in such a bad shape spiritually. He said, okay, you won. I said, really? I was surprised. I said, how did this happen? He said, you kept going. That's what faithfulness is. That's when I learned that no matter what, I keep going. You hardly find me canceling anything. I just did one recently, and now I'm on the other side of it. I said, I wish I had continued. Because now it costs me more money, and then so many things are different. He's faithful. He said, I can come anytime and I'll make up for lost time because I have the power to reverse what the enemy has accomplished. Mm-hmm. When I think about that text, he said, he always causes us to triumph. I've mentioned it 2 weeks ago. You don't know how he's causing you. You have to believe that he's causing you to triumph. He didn't say to win, but to triumph, meaning this will be such a victory that Satan can't come back from. That's what a triumph is. I said it years ago, this is the final game of the season, so it has to be the Super Bowl. And you have 3 seconds left on the clock, and it's 45 zip. There's no way you can come back. That's a triumph. But in this case, it's not even a perfect example because there's the next season, and then they can come back. But a triumph in the realm of the spirit, like Jesus triumphed over Satan, there's no way he can come back. There's no way. Forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Infinitum. You say he always. So God is always engineering my breakthrough, even when I don't feel it, don't think it, don't see it. Oh, this is going to be a great week. I can sense it already. The depth of word flowing out of my spirit. Hallelujah. You need to start celebrating where you are and thanking God that this word is for you. It's coming for you. So let's go to him. It's coming for you. It's coming for you. Because some of us went through so much, we never went to a meeting or some preacher or a revival meeting, healing evangelist or whatever. No, just in the secret place, along with God. That's where all these things have been wrought through the years. And that is why till tomorrow, not just today, I'm still not chasing after anything. I go to meetings, but most times when I go, I really don't hear anything that adds to me. It's just a review of what I already know. So I don't rush to those things. And yet I've been preaching for just in this ministry called Resurrection of All Nations for 20 years. And the word of God is as fresh today as it was 20 years ago. And even getting better still. That's the faithfulness of God. You can't beat it. That's why I brag on it. I brag on him and celebrating him every day. Amen. Connect with it. 770-994-3777. All the facilities for you to put your seed in the ground, to activate your faith. Because without faith in this kingdom, it's impossible. But just make sure you're hearing from God, not doing things presumptuously. That's what we're telling you. Only do what God is leading you to do. Because when he leads you, he will respond. God bless you. It's a great way to start this week. Remain blessed and receive in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. See you tomorrow.